Hi everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 26 of the BusinessEx learning series, Invest, Scale, Value and Exit. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and welcome, friends, and welcome to another edition with BusinessEx. And very, very happy New Year to you, because this is a year where we are all looking positively to the outlook of our businesses and the economy and so on and so forth, while I think we are still in between of a little bit of uncertainty how things are going to shape up. And today's session is actually going to be that. While in the last 25 odd sessions, what we have done is that we have really talked about largely about how to invest, scale, exit, and value your businesses. And today I'm going to take about a little bit of overview about how I think the outlook of 2021 is going to look like, how 2021 would shape, what kind of changes would happen, especially in the investment space, how the investors are going to look at it. But before we go 2021, we need to really go and see what happened in 2020 and this year looks promising, but we have to also really look at what happened in the last year. And the last year was, I would say, exceptionally, challenging, especially for some kind of businesses, because I felt that some businesses were, not able to really cover up, and they were not able to come up to the point where they can pivot themselves, and especially some hot startups really. Which were doing extremely well pre-COVID. I mean, one of them, say Oyo or places like that, brands like that. So they really had a huge amount of challenges, and we would certainly have to expect the next quarter to tell us the real results on how this needs to be done. But still, I mean, overall, if you really look at the industry viewpoint, there's some of the facts which I will share with you. There were 765 transactions still happened. Which is a great news from this is only April to December data. We had about 9 companies which started really getting valuations of becoming unicorns. $8.4 billion was raised. Also, it's not a significant number if you really see from a size of India viewpoint. I mean, $8.4 billion is not a very big number, but it was still being done, which is obviously 30% lesser than what happened in 2019. But a lot of other things happened. I mean, a lot of, early stage startups really had to shut down. I mean, I think a lot of businesses which were built to raise, and they were expecting their the first round or a second round to happen around the first quarter, were not able to sustain that long. And some of the companies, and especially the incubation centers I am closely working with, we saw some kind of challenges. Some have paused the business. That's still not a bad news. The reality would be that how much they would be able to come back and start sustaining. That would be a question to me. But a lot of people are on a pause mode. You know, so if you started a startup, say, late to 2019, and you didn't was able to do that, so you reduced your cost, you paused this entire thing, or you're just managing your business, but not doing too much at this stage. I would see some of them would start coming this quarter, and that would start showing some kind of a better trend to happen. But another thing which we saw in 2020 was a lot of realistic valuations. I think the valuations came down to a little realistic level. A good sign which I've started seeing, especially in the last two quarters, is the first quarter when this all happened, the money flow from at least the HNI and the large corporates stopped coming in because they were worried about their own businesses and how this would turn out and so on and so forth. And as the businesses started opening, the family funds really started coming back. So I am seeing a good trend now in that, especially in some sectors. I think good trends are already coming, which is like health tech, edutech. Edutech obviously has been one of the most exciting industries. While I would say a lot of changes would happen in the edutech space, fintech was a little slow. Fintech was not something which was to his expectation. FMCG saw a lot of, and I think a lot of investment went into FMCG. I would say FMCG, food processing, this would continue to see a very strong, I think gaming, OTT became, again, while India is not a big player on that, but I think we would see a more startups and more opportunities really coming in the OTT space. And enterprise software would continue to be steady growth. So that's something which was still very, very structured. But as we start looking at a path to recovery, and I think the focus is clearly for people to not only just focus on the survival and sustainability, but also go back to profitability and growth. And that shift, I think, would have to be defined, and which companies would be ready from moving from survival and sustainability. That's something which we've been talking the entire 2020, that everybody is talking about the survival and sustainability. But now I think companies are, investors are particularly looking at companies which can demonstrate growth, but with profitability. That's something which is very, very important. Only growth or scale, I think, would not be the really mantra of going forward. If you can demonstrate a bottom line along with that, that would be probably the next step to happening. Some of the sectors which I would see a particular large amount of focus going in is vocal for local. Today also Prime Minister came up and talked about it. While I've not seen so much being done in terms of the real policies coming out, which can encourage a large amount of startups coming in that space and helping them to really get some kind of early liquidity, some kind of support, especially on the manufacturing side, I don't see much has already happened. But there is a willingness, there is obviously a positive message, there is obviously a gap in the government funding also, so they don't have too much to really go out and create larger initiatives, what they did in the Startup India part of it. But I feel that there is a clear intent from a Prime Minister's office and the Niti Aayog and other players, they are looking at very clearly pushing this agenda. So this agenda should really create a lot of new startups coming in the manufacturing space and also to export opportunities and so on and so forth. So a lot would want to happen. And India obviously would take a edge on a couple of categories, which I think can be a very interesting opportunity going forward. So we're going to talk about today in terms of what is outlook for 2021 and how the next year would frame up. And some of the also areas which I felt was very important for the investors to look at is how you performed in these 9 months, particularly in the last 9 months. If the companies are able to sustain themselves and they are able to really put some kind of structure and demonstrate that they were really did that, and some were very rational, you know, they were just very, very, you know, they just wanted to put the, you know, the business at stop and not be able to do that. But few of them really started pivoting themselves and started looking at that a new way of doing business and so on and so forth. To me, those companies which have done, I would say, reasonably in the last 9 months would attract better investors. So investors would not go all over now. I think the money would still be difficult to attain, but I think they would start going into businesses which have been more resilient. And resilient businesses which would have, you know, not only focused on the top line part of it, but they've also really bottom line. They were actually able to do in this period. I've known some of the good startups. They were able to really find ways to generate their own cash. So they started doing some kind of attraction because it was forced upon them. So they started finding ways to really look at generating cash. There was overall sustainability in the structure. The structure was manageable. I think that's very, very important. And some startups really went out of proportion. So they're not able to manage any kind of adversity. So any sustainable infrastructure was there that would be able to do that. Another area which is a new working way of doing things. Some startups were not able to really do that. But a lot of startups, I would say, this is the area which we have done well as a overall business. That we've started adapting to this remote working and alliances. And another area which I feel has been a very important highlight is that how your organizational structure was, how you designed as a company, what your HR structure was. Some very heavy HR structures didn't do well. I mean, and they had to, I mean, the company like a CureFit or this fitness company, which was promoted by one of the founders of Mentra, he actually had to let go about 600 odd people in the first month itself. To me, it's a big call. It's a big call for the financial health of the business, but to get back to the same structure, to bring the whole organization back with the confidence would take a lot of challenge and doing that. So they are also shifting. A lot of companies are also now shifting their models to asset light. So they are looking at, like in my other company, we're getting a lot of companies coming to us and they're shifting into franchise model. Like Grofers have come to us. They've been a pure play online company. They've shifted themselves to now doing physical stores, but all franchise businesses. Similarly, a lot of companies is are now looking, rather than putting their own capex, they are looking at capital light growth models, which to me makes a lot of sense that you can shift to not putting your own capital and put the capital, whatever you have, reserve capital, into critical areas. Critical areas are consumer experience and things of that nature, but not necessarily go and put monies into which were depreciating assets and so on and so forth. So you can really bring in partners. So a lot of these micro partnerships or franchising or licensing or things of that nature has started coming in because the other capital was scared to get. So this all is making a lot of changes in the entire thing. So I feel that we are on the right track. We are right track for our path to profitability, but we have to keep our unit economics in mind. You know, any path to profitability should really continue to see, and you need to divide your organization into smaller units, and each unit has to see its own economics, and you need to really balance that economics. That proportion we should not lose. We should not go on to old ways of doing business just because of we feel that building very, very rational, that how you want to really build this situation so that you don't go out of proportion. So your unit economics of everything what you're doing is to be done very well. Some of the sectors I feel which would rise in the times to come and which has already done well in the last 9 months and I think also would do better are like, surprisingly, HR tech has done well. Clean tech has done well. Retail tech has been slow. It was lost. It has come back. And a lot of these hyper-local delivery, direct-to-home kind of infrastructure. So a lot of technology is going to be done there. We're still very, very far from what we really had to have as a last mile user experience. But I think that space is going to be very interesting. Mobility is where I would put my top dollar. I would say the mobility would have a very strong presence from India. India would see this, especially this EV space, for next 4 or 5 years or maybe more, would have a very, very strong capability. Other sectors which I think need more push and not too many startups are there is agri-tech. Agri-tech can be a very large opportunity for India. So these are areas which we need to really put more focus on. So these are kind of opportunities which I would say there would be a bigger opportunity. A lot of reinvestment would also be done. I think some companies which have survived and done well, they would go back to their investors and probably try to do another round with them. And I think the investors would also be welcoming that situation, because I feel rather than going out and investing into fresh assets, if your assets have done well and they have survived this period, reinvesting back to the same businesses would make more sense. And it will give confidence back to the promoters or founders of the companies that you're backing them at this stage. So I'm actually more of the viewpoint that you should really back some of the businesses which have been there and surviving rather than looking at a fresh investment. So I feel that the new startups would still continue to have a little challenge in terms of getting capital, unless and until you are something which is very disruptive and very clearly suited to current environments and so on and so forth. But companies which have been running and commercially proven, they would be able to attract more capital in these times. So that's more my viewpoint on that. And that where I would like to put my dollar on. I would like to put on businesses which already are commercially viable. And those are the businesses which would be able to attract the. Another thing which would be also, I think, in last 9 months was more about how do you preserve the whatever has been built. I think consciously, the next 2 quarters, I think we will see the growth spots coming in. And these growth spots would clearly be not going everywhere. It would become deeper in the markets. So that would be, I think, also should be demonstrated. I know a lot of startups, and I always give this example, like Oyo, went out in multiple other spaces, which was not good to do because they were expanding everywhere. They were expanding globally, and they were also doing a lot of vertical expansion. And that's something which has to cut down. I would see that a lot of assets which are non-core for businesses which would thin would come in the market. And there would be a consolidation on that. So say if Oyo went into a wedding business or a venue business, to me, that business has to be shelled off and to be integrated with much larger player, much focused player, to create a sensible venue business for that entire thing. Or if you had something else which was fitting into your business model, it might have to be shelved off to clearly define value. And I think this would be one of the areas which investors have to put the thinking hat and say that where they would like to see their companies, investee companies, make a conscious call on focus on key businesses and let out all the other businesses which are not part of their core capabilities and so on and so forth. So now if I have to define few things which I would like to see where the funding would come in the 2021, what people would like to do. First is some points I will share with you. One point I'm a big believer is the clarity of founders with their objectives and motivation. That's very, very clear. All the money really follows founders. Very clearly, the founders have to have a very clear what they want to do. And at this stage, they cannot sound confused. They need to be even more laser clear where they are and what they want to do in next 2 to 3 years. And very clearly, in a short term, define where is the cash coming from and how are you going to be making sense on that. At this stage, nobody is listening on 2 year horizon or a 3 year horizon. While that would be a parameter, but they would like to see end of tunnel, at least from a cash generation viewpoint, in the entire thing. Recently, one of the companies which we work with was acquired by an edutech company. And clearly the answer was that it was generating cash. And there was a certain amount of market share they were sitting on, they got a good valuation and they were acquired by a big edutech business. So clearly that if you are in that space where there is some kind of a value being built, you would be able to do that. Second is core valuation, a core value proposition. If you are very clear about your core value proposition, who you stand for, what is your product, where it is needs to be done, who's your customer base, all that pieces has to be clearly defined. Then only I think investors are looking at. Third point to me is focus on one market at a time. Don't spread thin. That's not the case at this moment. Like a lot of companies are coming to me and I give them advice that if you are going to compete with the giants tomorrow, first try to create your own cluster, fix that cluster, create a kind of entry barrier in that cluster rather than just spreading thin. Don't go everywhere. Like there is about now 212 EV startups in the country, which are registered themselves as EV manufacturers, electric vehicle manufacturers. These are big OEMs also, but there are a lot of startups that come in. Now, everybody is trying to go everywhere. You cannot do that. It's very difficult to do it. So I'm advising these companies that you create clusters. Take one state, go out and do a full down, deep down cluster, focus on one market, create your value in that. So tomorrow, then the big boys really start doing it. There would be value proposition you would have built in. You'll create your own audience group, and that's how the business has to be done. So we need to really see that not every company would really have ability or financial capability to go all over. So they need to really see through that they focus on one market at a time. Another area which is going to be a huge challenge for businesses and startups especially is talent. Talent is going to be a big, big problem. We have been, last 9 months, a lot of people have cut down costs, released a lot of people. Talent would shy away. Now these days, getting a talent and eventually retaining them would become a big problem. So you need to really see what are you going to do to get that, because people are facing two issues. You know, most of the people who are seeking jobs are seeking two issues. One, they are looking absolutely stability. So they're looking a long-term stability. They don't want to take any chances on that. Second, whatever they have lost as their market price, they want to go back or rather go back and maybe expect a little higher from the market price. So this is very emotionally to be handled, and this has to be done in a. And I think there is a more dropouts. So like there is a, I don't want to name the company, but this company really went out and hired a lot of people to work from home. Is a edutech business and gave them a little pieces. So a lot of people joined in because they didn't have jobs, because they felt that this was an opportunity which can give them some extra cash. As fast they got these numbers up, they're losing equally fast. Because as job market would start coming in, people would go back to the entire thing. So the opportunist approach towards talent would not work anymore. So people would have to really look at a permanent solution on. So more hiring now you do, don't do it from an opportunity viewpoint because you're getting talent at a cheaper price or something like that. You need to now start looking at good talent, which is available, and you have to might give up a little higher. So how do you design businesses to understand that? Design your organizational structures in a manner that you're not heavy on talent, but good talent is going to be a difficulty for a lot of businesses. Another area which you need to do is how do you design your organization would also change. And I think the older way of doing your organizational design might not work. So one of the TED Talks I was talking about that the new design organizations have to be very different. It has to be not the, by the departments of sales, marketing, and things like that. I would say that new departments have to emerge, like creativity can be one which it drives innovation, drives change cycles, and so on. So that's going to be one of the departments. Second is doing objectivity. You know, everything which is done in the organization should have a strong objectivity. Why are you doing it? And what is the entire thing? Accountability for every single stakeholder in the business has to be very important. And fourth is the purpose. A purpose starts missing. You know, why are we to start businesses? Because we want to create some kind of a solution, you know, for some problem. And most of the time, the problem is with the human life and things of that nature. So in any human, if there was some problem which we clearly can define and we create a solution for that, that's what the commerce really is all about. So this is where one has to really define what was the purpose you started this business and what was the problem you wanted to really solve. And understandably, we are very clear and keep reminding ourselves on that, businesses will not do that. So that would be a very important aspect. Sixth point would be to me how you are commission changed in this period. So while we all understand our businesses and state of our businesses, but we don't understand what has happened in this period for the competition. Has it moved up? How's it gone down? What is an opportunity? Where it is? So new assessment of your competitive landscape has to be very clearly done. So that we are able to understand where is the competition, where is the opportunity for you. Some of the sectors, I think there is a good opportunity for you to really go out and lead the way because the competition is not so aggressive at this moment for various reasons and so on and so forth. So people have different situations at this moment and their businesses. So you have to really assess your own competition to see where you are. So finally, I think I'm coming down to my next 4 or 5 minutes of my closing point. I would see that the area which would really create focus for 2021 would be the expectation would be clearly how do you stay focused on you know the purpose of the business? How do you stay focused on your digital adaptation? Digital adaptation is very, very important and demonstrate your scaling. Which would also not mean that you scale without showing commercial success in a near term, and I think which is 2 quarters or 3 quarters. Opportunities in India, I think there are tremendous amount of opportunities available. I feel that there is a huge opportunity which was unlocked for our global collaborations. A lot of companies, global companies, would see India as an opportunity to manufacture. I feel that that's going to be or produce or any kind of development. So see our global collaborations, work on reaching out rather than waiting for somebody to come out. I would say even the early startups should really look out companies out of Europe, US. I feel that when the markets start opening up, a lot of collaboration and deals would happen. Focus on tier 2, tier 3, tier 4. India is very large as a marketplace. So you need to really see how you spread yourself in these markets. These markets have given, especially at Franchise India Group, we saw a huge amount of opportunity in last year. 2020, I would say, is a good year for Franchise India. But all the business we really did was in smaller cities. And smaller cities came as a surprise to us. We did more businesses in the Gwalior's, in the Bhopal, and places like Ranchi and likes of them. So these opportunities surprise you. They're kind of a... people liquidity, people are sitting on the consumption which is happening in those markets would be much bigger. Now finally, I would say this also would end, this 2021 would also see a lot of M&A opportunities. Huge opportunities would come in. And I would divide these M&A opportunities into 3 parts. One is very clearly in the relatively mature sectors. Any sector which is largely mature has struggled in last 1 year, would have run out of cash or would have declining margins which are sitting there in the business because of the lesser sales, pressure on businesses, the margin wouldn't tighten. So there would be a lot of consolidation would happen there in these mature, relatively mature businesses. It can be auto, it can be telecom. We've obviously seen all the done, but if there is an opportunity, there might be another merger would happen. So M&A opportunities in mature sector is no brainer to me because of what has happened. So there is a, but in sunrise sectors like a edutech or a fintech or a companies like that, I think it will be chasing the innovation. Anywhere you will have a spark of innovation because these companies are relatively now sized, like the Baiju's and the likes of them, they would see any opportunity which is there, but has to be driven from pure innovation. Because they are logically getting into a size where they would get to the market and things of that nature. I also see a lot of IPOs coming in the 2021. This is going to be an IPO ride for this year and the next year. And in these cases, M&A becomes very interesting to really scale up your business to a certain size and structure. And investors would push that situation. So I would see a lot of work going on in the sunrise sector. I would also see the third kind of M&A deals would come in, which would be driven from investors, and investors would push the smaller companies to merge together to create a logical size to attract future investments and so on and so forth. So that would be, I would say, push mergers because investee companies, if investors would look at an investee company, and if they're not sizable, they're not able to do that, they would push these mergers together to make some kind of a logical business out of that. And we saw that happening in 2008. We saw that in early 2012-13, some of the companies were merged together to build some kind of a logical. We saw in e-commerce a lot happening in that time. I see the same thing now also coming up in this year. So this year is going to be very interesting in that sense because we see a lot of changes happening. At BusinessEx, we are aggressively working to help our startup community or our business community to raise capital and also help them in terms of, if they're looking at opportunities of M&A or looking at exit, we are helping them on doing it. So over to you, Sonali, for if you have any questions for me, then I can see on a Q&A box some questions are there. So we can take some questions and then we can.
Sure. So thank you so much for another wonderful session, Gaurav sir, and for sharing your valuable insights with us. I'm sure it was helpful to all our business owners and investors attending the session today. So we do have quite a few questions lined up with us. I'll just take them up one by one. So the first question we have is, will hospitality startups funding see any growth as the industry is very volatile right now?
This is no brainer to me that this hospitality or travel would come back faster than we know as the business gets onto normal, but rather it'll see spike. I would say this would be a greater opportunity to really look at. But if anything interesting is there in the market, investors would love to look at investments in this space. And investors don't look at the current situation. They look at future. They look at how the businesses are going to unturn themselves in next 3 to 4 5 years. So I feel that we don't see the sector from a current performance of the sector viewpoint. See the from a horizon viewpoint what it is going to do, and that's how people invest. And most of the times people invest into futuristic and look at what is happening on this. Tesla's valuation, it's ridiculous. It's because of something which is futuristic. It's something which is taken from conventional car companies, conventional technology businesses, valuation to a very different level, purely from thing which is going to unlock in next 4, 5, 10 years. And so his balance sheet is not supporting that. So it's essentially, so please try to understand if you have anything which is futuristic, investors love it. And they like that situation. They like the change. They like the shift of the customer. They like disruption. So all these are very important aspects.
Absolutely. And on similar lines, we have another question that says, what are the new paths or sectors that are created due to the coronavirus pandemic where startups can emerge?
So I think this startups in anything which is coronavirus has really one of the big thing is that how do you do businesses and run these businesses with the remote situations and automation to me was very important. Automated everything from manufacturing, distribution, everything would be very important. So a lot of these ideas which were very clearly everybody talked about in the past, but never did it. But in the COVID, they were pushed to do it. And like the startups which were in the logistics space, to me, came very, very strong in this period. And they all performed. And I would put even more money behind this sector, because I feel that India still is far away from our logistic capabilities and doing it at all levels. So those are areas which I think have risen, apart from the visible ones, which we clearly know, direct to home and edutech and other things. And I think I still feel that there's a lot of other sectors which are there. And I think agritech to me is a very strong case. This should have been one of the agendas, which should be driven by the central government and so on and so forth. So we have a lot of sectors which can really improve lives of average Indian, and that shows all sectors to me would be very, very promising.
Sure. The next question we have is, what is the future prospects for real estate franchise sectors for the coming years?
Real estate franchise sectors?
Yeah.
Real estate franchise sectors, I didn't understand. I mean, you were talking about real estate franchise broking sectors? Who asked this question?
Mr. Sudipto, if you can just reply on this.
Real estate franchise, one of the real estate franchise sectors would mean, I mean, if this question is around real estate broking being franchised, because developers community doesn't do franchising, but if that is a question, then obviously, maybe by the time he comes with clarity, then we take the next question.
Sure. So the next question that I'd like to take up is, some companies are raising capital through cryptocurrencies. What are your views on this?
Yeah, so cryptocurrency is also now stabilized. So I'm not authority on crypto. I'm not either invested myself, neither I make a comment. But whatever I read from where it is today, it has stabilized. So a lot of people are raising capital, and eventually, any currency or any trading form would come in that has to have both. It has to have, you need to invest, then only the trading cycle would complete. So they have to invest. So fundamentally, crypto would be investment in time. I still would feel that how effective it would be, how easily it's available, how you will be able to raise that. These are all questionable things in that. But yes, it is there to stay. It is there to stay. And some countries have adapted much better. Some few European countries, some Singapore and other places. And India is also seeing some action going on that. But while we have still ambiguity and clarity in terms of a few things which is there. But yes, it is a possibility.
Sure. The next question that I'd like to take up is, since COVID-19 has also highlighted environmental change as a huge issue of the present and the future, as a fashion industry startup, how much do you see sustainable fashion or luxury goods startups growing in India?
So, India, the consumption is not a problem. You know, you can be in any sector, you can be luxury or, sustainable fashion. There is enough and more customer groups available in the market. I would say what differentiation you bring in the market, how do you compete, especially in the sectors like luxury, it's very, very competitive and it's very difficult to really hit these, especially European brands. They're very mature in operations and so on and so forth. So how do you really bring that? I mean, India should do it. I mean, there is a lot of work being done in China by Chinese startups in the luxury space, in every thing. It can be cosmetics, it can be other things. But India has not seen so much. I mean, we've seen few. We've seen some of the bridge to luxury kind of brands. Forest Essential was invested by Louis Vuitton Capital very early because they had a very strong promise. I would have seen Forest Essential going much bigger globally as a business, but I saw a strong promise of a luxury brand being built from India. So not many big examples are there, but there are a few good examples which have happened. Kama is a good example in a luxury Ayurveda product, I think. But we're still not having a strong luxury player in the country from a startup viewpoint. But there is an opportunity which exists, obviously, which needs to be done. I also feel that a lot of our designers had ability to do it, but they also didn't do. The Indian designer story was very big to really go global and build a very big, but it's not really taken off. It's very strong in India, but it's not a global situation.
Right. The next question that we have is about the agritech sector. So I'll just combine two questions that we have related to it. The first one is, does agritech has scope in tier one or metro cities as the competition is much higher? And the second question is, do you think agritech is underrated? Why is it not as popular when we compare it to tech or edutech sectors or startups?
So it's a very unique situation. You know, anything which becomes successful, everybody wants to follow that. So, but who makes it successful? When you have one unicorn in agritech, then everybody would come in that space. So it's success follows success. So it's not really people don't want to do it. It's just about interest of these people to invest into the sector really comes from when it starts seeing some success stories, when the first investment, big investment would come, or some big marquee investor would come and invest and back that initiative. Then you will see everybody getting into that. So agritech is waiting for that to happen. And I'm very, very sure 2021 is all about that. You can hold me on this, that I would say that there would be a few investments in this space.
Absolutely. The next question that we have, sir, is that there is a lot of activity in the telemedicine space in healthcare. How do you see that as a maturing sector and as a means of attraction for investment?
So this has been, we've been talking about this for the last 3-4 years, and telemedicine is to me a very important aspect of making healthcare inclusive. There is no other way India can address a healthcare situation. Actually, if you really ask me, we were absolutely not ready. When I see a mayor of London saying that NHS would not be able to handle the cases, I really thought oxy about India, where there was no ability to handle. I mean, at least they're coming and say we don't have beds and that thing, but really ask me, how does we have in any form ability to handle this pandemic or any other health hazard or something like that, or even to bring in a basic primary health care to our last mile villages and things of that nature. So telemedicine, I think, should be a government agenda. It should be a very strong agenda. Basic healthcare is very important, and you can only address in this country by telemedicine and things of that, at least primary healthcare. And I feel that that's something to me is a very strong, but again, so you have to always understand that any business where investors try to go is also to see where they're going to find 4 years, 5 years valuations, commercial success of that piece, and so on and so forth. So sometimes in some sectors you don't clearly see that. So these sectors, really, while we know that there is a much need from in the market, but people don't invest into those sectors because they feel that this is not going to get the commercial success, so to say. So unless and until I think we clearly start defining and we put some initiatives on around that, and there is a so then I think everybody would back that.
Sure, sir. So I know we are running out of time, so I'll just take up the last two or three questions now. One question that I would like to take up is, what is the scope for mental health startups in 2021, according to you?
It's very niche to me. Mental health, if there is some kind of work being done, obviously that is a genuine problem. And not only for one healthcare problem. I mean, if you pick up any part of the healthcare, mental health is obviously very ignored in markets like India. And it's become a very serious subject globally for last 10 years and not been done so much in India. But so these are good sectors. This is what I really keep telling every startup and say, just don't chase others in that thing. Find out your own problem area which you want to solve. And there is so much of problems, out there which are there. And you can just pick up one you have some kind of domain specialization. Just because you read something, you don't want to follow that, that's not in that thing. Or you have somebody who's a domain specialist with you on that. Work on that domain and do deep dive into that. And every of these problems have a humongous opportunity. Every of these problems is a $1 billion company. So there is all everything you touch in India can become a $1 billion. That's not a problem. Issue is that how in depth you go into those businesses is more important.
Absolutely, sir. And finally, the last question I would like to take up is, do you think the edtech space is saturated, as every second there is a new startup in the space? Is this space already reached a point of consolidation?
No. So edtech, if I have to break down into this piece, is a very at this stage also, I think it is passing through a discovery process. A discovery process is when you are not too sure where the end customer is going to land and how this is landing. And you have different issues here. You have to understand there is a regulator, there is a conventional education practice, there is infrastructure being deployed. So a lot of things are going on. And EduTech also should understand that what is going to lead to, technology, I think, would be enabler and will become at a certain level flat, while you would continue to do the user experience capabilities, but it would become even bigger. But the real difference would come from content and delivery. The content and delivery would play a very, very important role, and that side is still yet to be completely done. So, and I feel that unless and until you do the full cycle of that and somebody is in, I think it's still 3-4 years away. So, which means that any genuine work in terms of, the innovation done in edtech would really see a strong investments coming in. The sector is becoming very exciting, very, very exciting. A lot of money is already there. So, any kind of investment which you need to do, any kind of disruption or innovation would attract a very strong investment case to me. But specialization would play. So anyway, you have to understand any sector passes through this own unorganized way of doing to organized to little bit of what I call specialized, and specialized to personalized. So I think we are going from a specialized to personalized piece. And there would be a lot of work being done. And so you will see the sector in news almost every day for the 2021. The sector is going to do that. But but there is a lot of still a path to be done. We still have unanswered questions on how the formal examinations would happen, how testing would happen, how this would happen. So a lot of these are not being done. So when these all connecting of dots would start happening and it will come in the mainframe, then I think what we are talking about is very, very different. I mean, you can have an ed tech company in India which can be valued at $100 billion. So now this is a very big number to really think through and looking at where I'm at this stage of the business is. But it is not big to really, from the canvas viewpoint, this is not a big thing to really see that one of the richest persons who is in the world is actually an ed tech player from India. So that's something which I would leave you with a thought process. So, and that's exactly what next 4-5 years India is going to do, especially in few of the tech sectors.
Sure, sir. So with this, we'll just wrap up the Q&A session. We still have a lot of unanswered questions. So I apologize to anyone whose question could not be answered, but please feel free to ask any questions that you might have to Gaurav sir directly. So, sir, if you can just...
I my email ID, because it's difficult to answer all questions in a short period. So please write to me and I will give you full understanding of that. And even if I don't have a complete understanding of your sector, which you are asking, because sometimes people go in specific sectors, I'll read through it and I'll come back to you what I would be, it would be my, so to say, understanding of that. So please send it to me. And if you have anything which we can help you in terms of raising your capital or helping you to even set your valuation, anything else out there, I think reach out to Sonali and she'll be able to help you.
Absolutely, sir.
My email ID is called gm@gauravmarya.com.
Sure, sir. So we do have quite a lot of questions asking if BusinessEx can help them in their fundraising journey and help them connect with the right investors. So anything you would like to add on to that, sir?
Yeah, absolutely. That's what we do. And especially in the early stage space, we are a mid-market player in this space for anybody to raise capital. And another thing which is very important is that a lot of technology-based businesses essentially still find an ecosystem. But we are also specialist on non-technology businesses. When I say technology is part of every business now, you cannot be in that thing. But if you are, say, a consumer brand and you want to really do something, So we are very, very good at it. And both for investments from strategic investors and also from the financial investors, there's a lot going on in India in the consumer space. So if you have anything which needs to be done, another thing which you have a business which has an idea to scale through franchising. While it should not be done when you're very early, because sometimes people come with an idea and they say, I have no proven business and want to franchise. And we've done that in past, but I'm not a big fan now on doing it. And I don't want to really step into that unless and until there. And if you have any startup which you feel is really ready for franchising and you feel that franchising can work and franchisee can make money, then reach out to me personally and I will love to evaluate that. And if there is an opportunity to invest, I will be the one who would come along with you to invest into that business.
Absolutely, sir. So with this, we'll just wrap up the session. So thank you so much, Gaurav sir, for your valuable insights and for a wonderful session as always. And thank you to all our attendees. We really hope we were able to add value to your lives through this session. And if you have any questions, any concerns, or you want to know more about BusinessEx and how we can help you, so please feel free to reach out to me or to Gaurav sir, and we would be more than happy to have a look and help you out in your journey. Anything you would like to say in the end, sir?
And I would say for 2021, the message is very clear. Don't wait the world to change. Change the world. Go out and change your own environments, the businesses you run, the way you run, everything change. This is an opportunity. This is an opportunity for everybody. I say this 1 year of 2020 has one thing in common with every single human on this earth. Everybody has some problem. There is nobody who's come out of this year which would say, I had no problem. There would be some problem. It might be small. It might be your children not going to school. It might be something, you have an elder at home which was not keeping well or something. And one thing is also very common in this year, we all had, which is learning. We learned something. So what I think is that I would like to remember 2020 as a year of learning and move from there. And everybody should use and implement those learnings, whatever you got. And use it in 2021 to rise and grow. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And to all our attendees, please join us next week. This is a weekly series that we do, and every week we take up topics from investment, scaling up, valuation, and exiting your business. So if you're interested in topics like these, then please join us next week, next Saturday at 3:00. Thank you so much.
Thank you.